welcome to the only program that articulates the issues affecting women, their children, and their families. My name is Rebekah Awuah, and throughout history, women traditionally have been the backbone of society. While men have gone off hunting or fighting, it has always been the woman who have quietly stayed behind to run everything in their absence, caring for their children and other relatives, managing the home, and simply being there when if the menfolk returned. Currently, reports has it that over 2 million working mothers are the biggest earners in their families, a rise of 80% in the last 15 years, and in nearly a third of couples with children, the mother is the breadwinner. For many women, bearing the mantle of breadwinner comes with a significant of pressure. Women, the new breadwinners, is a subject for Women's Voice with an all-important guest. As a child, I, and even till now, looked up to her as a mentor, surprisingly unknown to her. She is no other than Rev. Dr. Joyce Rosalind, former CEO of the Chamber of Mines and the Executive Director of Salt and Light Ministries. I'm privileged to have you.
Thank you, Rebekah.
On this platform.
Thank you, Rebekah. I didn't know that I was a mentor to you. Well, I'm glad to know that. Now we can deepen the relationship.
Exactly. Yes. And let me say that your way of dressing informed the way I sew this kind of clothes.
Lovely. I think it's very elegant. You know, I really maintain that being corporate does not necessarily have to be a black and black or gray and gray also, and that we can use our fabrics to create a very strong, powerful statement of corporate attire. I maintain that.
And it looks good on you. So
Thank you.
I
think people will be shocked if I wore anything else. So I've decided this is how I am.
We're waiting for that day.
No, it won't happen. It won't happen.
All right, let's come back to our issue for discussion.
Yes.
Women, the new breadwinners. It speaks volumes, doesn't it?
Well, I'm not sure that women are the new breadwinners. If what you said at the beginning holds true, then it means that women have been breadwinners for years. Because in the era where men went hunting and fighting, it still was the women who were taking care of the home. So I think that maybe there's a certain new breed, but I think women have always played that role. I mean, I am the product of a woman as a breadwinner for various reasons. My father died and my mother had to take care of us. And so I grew up in a single parent home. And so my mother was the breadwinner. Even in homes where perhaps the father would be alive or something, you know, in polygamous situations, usually the women take care of their children. And there are times also where the men are there. I'm sorry to say this, and I don't mean to really run down our men, but there's a certain sense of irresponsibility where because women cannot bear to see their children not going to school, not eating and so on, there are some men, and let me stress, some men who abdicate their roles as the breadwinners of the home. They may be living in the home, but really, they are like tenants, you know, leaving a lot of the responsibility to the women. So I would say that, yes, a lot of women play the role of breadwinners, but it's not a new phenomenon. It's not a new phenomenon.
It has existed.
It has existed, even though your statistics shows that it has increased.
Yeah, yes. Sure. Mm. But let's come to the definition of a breadwinner. Who exactly is this person?
I think if you just even take the word breadwinner and break it into two, bread stands for food, staple. And then winner, it means the one who goes to bring what it takes to provide food, to provide shelter, to provide clothing, you know, the one who takes care of the home. That's how I'll put it.
But who is responsible for doing this originally or traditionally, if I should put it that way?
If we go the way of traditionally, we'll get into trouble, because in some traditions, it will be totally unheard of for a woman to be a breadwinner unless she's a widow. And in some societies, even when she's a widow, she's supposed to be the responsibility of a man's family. That's how some traditions are. In some also traditions, it is expected that is the woman who will take care of her children. But what I'll say is that if I'm speaking from a biblical perspective, then I will say that the man is supposed to be the breadwinner. It's supposed to be the provider. It's supposed to be the protector. It's supposed to be the one who actually creates the conditions for the woman to be able to nurture children and take care of them. And yet, interestingly, when you read Proverbs 31 and from 10 to 31, it's obvious that it is that woman of virtue who's the breadwinner. It's very interesting. Oh. Yes, when you read it. Because she provides everything.
But we haven't thought about that as a society, have we?
We haven't. But you know, I think that there's a certain instinct in women to really nurture, to protect, to provide for their children. Now, I can't see a woman saying that, well, today your father has not put any money on the table, so we will all starve. No, she wouldn't do that. She would make sure that the children eat, sometimes even at the expense of herself not finding enough food. And of course, we'll quarrel with the man when he comes home. We've heard on the news and read in the papers sometimes where a man gets angry and even assaults a wife because he didn't put money on the table and he's expecting food. You know, it's happened in our society. It happens like that. So what I'll say is that there's this instinct in all of us that if the man comes to marry me, and therefore he should take care of me. You know, that really, you would say, is the thinking. But these days, it's a shared responsibility. You know, I mean, two people love each other. They decide to build a home. They decide to use their joint income to create a very congenial environment for their children to grow in. They decide to send their children to private schools. They are expensive. They decide to provide certain facilities for their children. They are expensive. And so this joint income enables them to do that. And when the income becomes joint, I suppose you don't want to sort of split it down the middle and say, well, I, the woman, I'm earning 10,000 Ghana cedis, and therefore I put in more, and you are only earning 5,000 cedis, so you couldn't have put in more. I think that once they decide to share the responsibility, then it is a shared responsibility. And both of them decide to go along that way. I know some homes where the father pays the rent, the utilities, and so on, and the mother then takes care of the food and some of the clothing for the children. So,
but in a situation where there isn't a shared responsibility.
Oh, that's a problem.
Yes, and
that is a problem because, you know, once you are married, there is a shared responsibility. Each person has a role to play. And so even if the woman has a lot of money and is doing everything, there's a resentment that the man is not doing anything. There's a resentment, no matter how much money the woman has. In fact, I suspect that even where the woman is the sugar mommy, after a while, she will feel resentful that the man does nothing. Because, you know, you're supposed to have a relationship. You're supposed to do things together. You know, it's not about who brings in what, but the fact that you're supposed to do things together is very important, you know. So I know some women will go out and marry men who have nothing and will do everything. But you see, in turn, they expect the men to be also very obedient and willing to do everything that is said, you know. So I would rather go for the shared responsibility, but I do admit in Ghana, there are many homes where it is the women who are the breadwinners. It's not a recent phenomenon. Mm. It has existed for a long time.
Okay. But going back to my earlier submission, I made mention of the fact that it has risen. The number of women doing this, what is accounting for the rise?
I guess a number of things. A number of things. I would have loved it if we knew how many homes are single parent homes where the woman is having to take care of the children by themselves.
We are not privy to the statistics, yes, but relatively, but it's on the high side.
Yes, if it's on the high side, that would account for the rise. Because I think that where there is marriage, I will still maintain that the norm would be the shared responsibility and not the woman taking up the whole responsibility of providing for the husband and providing for the children as well. This is not to say that it doesn't exist. It does happen. Where the woman provides for the man from clothing to pocket money and for other leisurely and pleasurable things, and then takes care of the children as well. There are some homes like that. And now, if single parent homes are on the increase, then it's not surprising to find many women still taking care of their children, taking care of the home.
But in a situation where a woman takes care of almost everything, including the man,
and providing,
wouldn't it pose a challenge at home?
It will. I mean, the man has to be a super loving person, useful in other areas, you know, giving the woman the sense of being loved and appreciated. That way, it wouldn't cause a problem. Because when the woman feels that if he had it, he would do it. And to compensate, he does so many things that make up for the fact that it is I who bring the money. You see, in some homes, I can imagine it happening like that. The man is very useful and does everything that is required, provides the love, the warmth, the protection, the dignity that the woman would like in the marriage. And so the woman will also say, well, I am blessed to be the one who earns the money. And I'll bring it because whilst he's not bringing the money, he's bringing so many other things that perhaps even money cannot buy. That way, there would be no conflict in the home. How many such are there? I cannot tell. It must be a very difficult situation. And I guess it must be also very difficult for the man to actually find himself not making a significant contribution to the home. And here, I would say, it's not just money. It's not just money. So even if the woman is the one who wins the bread, the man can also do many things that would bring the shared responsibility that I'm talking about. Yeah.
But some have also argued that some way, somehow, it brings about power struggling and imbalances at home.
Oh, definitely.
Are they right to be saying that?
I think there are some situations, yes. There are a number of situations, yes. Because, you know, there are some men who are bossy. They are bossy and they are tyrants and, you know, they want to put their finger on you and make you know you are a woman, you are down there, and so on and so forth. Now, if you marry a man like that and he's not taking care of you, there will be problems. There are bound to be problems because, you see, there will be rebellion in your heart that, look at him, being a tyrant in my life, but he doesn't even provide the food we eat. That would bring problems, you know. But I don't think it's the money alone that creates the problems, the power struggles and so on. Sometimes even the very profession that the woman has vis-a-vis what the man has can create the power struggle. Because I think whenever it is felt that the woman wants to be the leader of the house, you know, wants to be the one who takes the final decisions, I think then it brings a lot of struggles, you know, because the man feels that he should be doing that. And if the woman also considers that, well, he's not doing it, he either procrastinates too much, or he takes forever to come to a decision, or doesn't want to contribute anything, there are bound to be these issues, you know. But I think when it comes to just the issue of money, a woman can always manage it in such a way that the man does not feel that you are earning 6,000 as the man, I'm earning 10,000. But we are both earning. Mm. And when we put it together, we can get very far, you know. I know women, you know, we love marriage. So sometimes we don't think and then we go in. And then we go and find that maybe we are not as compatible as we thought we were, you know. And some of us are so desperate to get married that we will marry down. By marrying down, what I mean is that you have a certain profession. But the other day I heard a story. The woman has a profession, is even doing a master's in the profession. The man is only an SHS person trying to work for himself. Even needs a loan from the woman to go and do, you know, I mean, really, that's like marrying down, you know, where the man does not feel that he's really providing the leadership. That is right. There's bound to be trouble. No matter how nice you are, if you close late, because that's what your job requires, you know, it's a question of why do you close late? You know, if you speak to your boss, who happens to be a man, it's a problem. Wherever you go, you can't talk to other people. When you go to church, you're too busy in church, you know, all those things. But perhaps the fundamental issue is that you've married down and you're not able to manage harmony in the relationship. Yeah.
So how do families find the balance in the instance where the woman becomes, let me put a quote unquote, the automatic
breadwinner? Again, you see, people get married because they say they love each other. And love has a way of accepting weaknesses, flaws, and so on, not because you are blind to them, but you see something much more, something beyond the weaknesses and the flaws. And so you decide that the two of you can live together. And so if there's real love between the two of you, you should be able to find the balance. You can't even, in fact, I would even require that if a man found out for some reason, maybe he's going to be out of a job for a while, and the woman is going to have to be the one who provides anything, everything, I would expect the man to sit with the woman and say, well, my dear, this is the situation. There's this redundancy. It's affected me. It will take me a little time to find another job. So unfortunately, you're going to have to bear the cost of everything. Now, once there's that understanding, and once the man, as I said, you know, women, we love to feel loved and accepted and petted and pampered and so on. Now, if you're able to do that, then because you have discussed it earlier, the woman, if she's even feeling bad about it, because it perhaps is taking so long, I think she will overlook those things because you play your other roles as a man, you know. So the balance is really between the two people. Now, are you in competition with each other? You know, married people should not be in competition with each other. They should not be in competition with each other. They are supposed to complement each other. So whenever complementing becomes competing, harmony will not be in the house, because what it means is that it's like, I want to be better than you. He says, I want to be better than you. And it's always as if the MPP and the NDC are in contest, you know, or Hearts and Kotoko are in contest, or What are these European teams?
Real Madrid and Liverpool,
Liverpool
Manchester.
And Chelsea and Man U and so on. You know, that kind of strong rivalry. Strong rivalry. If you have that kind of strong rivalry, you are not going to find balance. You are not going to find balance because each of you is so selfish that you are pursuing your personal agenda. You're not pursuing an agenda of the two of us together, and if we have children, the two of us providing the leadership for the children. But it's I, me, myself. That is where the competition comes. I, me, and myself. That is the interest. And you don't want that kind of situation. Whenever you feel like that, if you feel strongly about yourself and yourself and yourself and yourself, I would say don't go and get married. Because when you get married, you have to share, even yourself. The first thing you do is you share yourself. Yeah. You know, you have to share yourself. And you have to admit that you're going to live with somebody who grew up in totally different circumstances, you know, and has different habits. You know, I, for example, I like my bed to be beautiful and straight. Even when I have an afternoon nap, when I wake up, I want to straighten, yes. Assume I go and marry somebody who likes the bed, you know, frutum frum and so on. I guess I'll die before my time, you know, or else, you know, we'll be quarreling. But then I'll have to find a very clever way of making him love a straight bed, you know. So, you know, you can create the conditions. I think women have a certain power that we don't often use. It's the power of charm. Is the power of a gentle spirit, you know, which can win every argument. You know, sometimes when the argument gets hot, I guess you can walk away and then come back, you know, and do it. But we have some strengths, which I think we can bring in. But the trouble is when two people are too selfish to subjugate themselves to each other, you know, to sublimate their interests to the common interest. Because the day you get married, there's a common interest of two people who have decided to be together. And when the children come, it's an even greater common interest. Because now, neither you nor the husband are living for yourself. The two of you decided to bring some human beings into the world. They didn't ask you to. You see, you, out of your love, did it. And out of love, you should be able to raise them. So it's very important for us to break down our selfish interests. Mm. Yeah.
To complement each other.
To complement each other, not to compete. Mm.
But the issue of women being the breadwinners seem to be a border to most men. Why should this be the case?
Well, you see, if they have the means to provide, then they should not make the women the breadwinners. They should be the breadwinners. In fact, they should be the breadwinners. Now, you talked about men hunting. The men hunted for the meat that was useful, was going to be used for the food. And if the woman was engaged in any agriculture at all, planting herbs and vegetables and so on, but the real thing that they were going to eat and so would be provided by the man, you see. So if you're a man and it bothers you, then please, provide for your wife and your family. There are times that perhaps circumstances will not permit you to be the one who's earning a much higher income than the woman. Again, if the woman has not started throwing her weight around and throwing your things out of the room, you should not impose it on her. You know, there are times when you impose a certain idea on somebody when the person has not even thought about it. If for some reason your income becomes less than that of your wife, it's a matter of discussion and finding where you can both share the responsibilities, you know. And I know many women will not mind doing that. But you can't expect me to provide everything and then you get angry. What for? Why should you? If you don't want to get angry, please provide it. That's how it should be.
But how well does a woman climbing the educational ladder got to do with them becoming, would I call it, a good breadwinner?
Mm. Oh, I guess it has to do with a good job and a good income. Because the more educated you are, the better your chances of getting a good job. And if even if you want to work for yourself, the better your chances of doing a good job at that. So naturally, the more educated women are, the more they are able to earn good incomes, you see. But you see, the more educated women are, the better the way homes are managed. Because the woman feels very responsible for the home. So she would do everything to make the home a wonderful place to be in. So she would spend her income doing that. And if, for example, she feels that maybe the man does not earn enough and they've talked about it and so on, she would not mind taking up the role of being the one who provides the food, who provides the clothing for the man and the children. Who provides the housing and so on. So long as there's understanding and she does not feel that she's being used, misused, and abused, then I think she'll be fine.
Oh. This discussion is getting very interesting.
And time is running out.
Yeah. And it's still Women's Voice, the only platform where we articulate issues affecting women, their children, and their families. And I can see your submissions keep coming in on our WhatsApp platform. Do not worry. Just take time.
We will answer all
your questions and put up all your comments on our platform. It is still Women's Voice. We're discussing women, the new breadwinners, with the chief...
Former chief executive officer of Chamber of Mines. And now a simple executive director of Salt and Light.
A simple executive director of Salt and Light.
Salt and Light Ministries. A ministry that God helped me to found.
Wow. Mm. So you just stay with us. We'll be back. Aunt Joyce is still here. We have more to discuss.
Yeah.
We share the unique stories of women within our society.
I see you having a beautiful wedding, but after that wedding, I see you chewing cola nut and weeping because you can't have kids.
Experiences that touch lives.
Whatever he allows into your life is for a purpose. Whatever it is, I'm sorry.
Okay, that's okay.
Imagine somebody who was a virgin, got married, and then the husband was infected and then gave it to him unknowingly.
We answer many questions every woman needs to know about their relationships, children, family life, and global events. Women's Voice, impacting the lives of women within our society. Showing every day at 4 p.m. on GBC 24.
Welcome back. Now, let me visit our social media platform where we have people putting in comments and all, and I'll get back to Aunt Joyce very shortly so that we discuss some of the pertinent issues. And now on our WhatsApp platform, let's see, this person, you did not give your name, but you're saying, how is this possible? I think the subjects of discussion, how is the women becoming breadwinners possible when from creation God has made it that men becomes the automatic breadwinners? Mm. You didn't give your name, but that is your comment. And I'm a lady in the same profession with my husband, earning the same amount, even him much more than I do. and because he is at a higher rank, but he always complains of money, even if salaries are paid today, making it difficult for me to cope because I spent almost everything I earn without saving a penny. Mm. And Joyce, I guess you would have to comment on that.
That's a tough one. That's a tough one. You know, when couples are getting married, especially if they are going to get married in a church, they are counseled. And money is always raised. Attitude to money. What will you do with money? Mm. Is always raised because it's true. Money has a way of creating rifts and problems. So the issue is, poor lady, she probably feels that the man is cheating. You know, because if he earns more, what is it that he's doing with his money that would make him not have it to provide what he should? And even if it's because he's building, if the building is for the two of them, should be discussed so that she will know that this is because the property we are developing or the mortgage we're paying is coming from his resources and therefore is making it difficult. But without discussing, but always complaining and shifting the burden to the woman, lady, I will tell you, please sit with your husband and discuss the issue. Because obviously, you're not happy. You're not happy about what is going on. And if you bottle up, you know, this growing unhappiness, it will boil over to resentment and create a lot of problems in the home. The man who says, why should it be possible? Indeed, I said it, yeah, that in the scheme of things, the men should be the providers and the protectors. But a lot of times they don't. Sometimes they don't. When you get to polygamous marriages and so on, you find that, you know, they just make the children and then walk away. Other times, they just make the children and walk away, even if they are not polygamously involved. Sometimes they are in the home, but they are absentee fathers and absentee husbands, in the sense that you hardly see them. So really, no woman, I can assure you, no woman joyfully becomes the breadwinner. I can assure you from a woman's perspective that women would love to be taken care of, including even our manicure and our pedicure. If you can pay for that for us, we would love it. You know, I don't do that, but you know, can you imagine me going to do my hair and, you know, having it paid for? Wouldn't it be nice?
It would be.
Yeah, it would be. If you have a husband who's willing to do all that for you, it'd be nice.
Exactly.
Yeah.
This one is coming from Nanama from Abelinpe. She says, I love the topic. I'm learning a lot. Auntie Joyce, you're on point. God bless you.
Amen to that.
And this is from, there's no name to this, but she's saying, please, I'm a lady who is 25 years of age, not yet married, very God-fearing, and above all, very God-fearing. And I, oh no, your message is not so clear.
Mm.
Mm. Well, she wants to say that advise her on the man she would have to choose as a husband. I think that is the point she wants to make.
The first one is that the man should be very God-fearing also. Because if the person is God-fearing, then he will understand this whole mystery of marriage. Also, you should love the man. It's not, oh, I'm 25, my biological clock is ticking, and therefore, well, yeah, you know, I don't really love him, but it will be well. No, don't do that. Also, please don't marry down, in the sense that don't marry somebody who educationally is lower than you and does not have the opportunity to get better. Sometimes at the beginning, the person may be lower than you, but has the potential to go even higher. You know, for example, if you are in a profession that is bound to give you a lot of money and you go and marry a taxi driver who is not driving his own car, but is spare driving. Do you get me? Spare driving means if there's no car from a friend, he doesn't have any income. Yes. But if the person is working regularly, then a taxi driver also earns a lot of money and can daily bring in income. So you have to you know, seek the face of God and make sure that you're going to marry somebody who's going to love you and cherish you as you also love him and cherish him, respect him, and so on, and that you're going to build a home together with Christ as the center of the home.
All right, this one too is from Reverend Commander from Kaswa, and he's saying, God bless you, Mommy Joyce. You are blessing the nation.
Amen.
Thank you. Women, this one says, women should help men financially because men can't provide all due to the bad economy. Anyway.
But that's why I said, once you get married, it's a shared responsibility. Once you get married, it's a shared responsibility. These days, one income is not enough. So even if your husband wanted to be the total breadwinner, he can't do it because a lot of things that you want to provide in your home and for your children requires two incomes. That's why I said a shared responsibility. It requires two incomes, you know. And what we are talking against is the fact that it is the woman who has to bring her income for everything. That is what we are talking about. That really, that is not the ideal. In fact, it shouldn't even be considered the norm. Even though it's happening, it shouldn't be considered as a norm. It has to be a shared responsibility.
Okay. This one says, AJ from, is it Hunhunya? Mm-hmm. I'm really enjoying your program. Keep it up. I want to know more about women's voice. Yes, it is a program that articulates issues that affect women. And we give them the platform because usually women don't have the voice.
Yeah.
Yes, so mm-hmm. we are the voice for the voiceless women. Okay, let's touch on the subject of discussion. Is it only a situation for married couples?
Oh, well, if you're talking about breadwinners, then yeah, I would even talk more about single parent homes where the mother is the single parent in the home. Then she's bound to be the breadwinner. Because if she has children and even the man is supporting the children, the man will never be able to bring enough to cover everything that the children need. So I expect that it is happening more in single parent homes where the woman is the primary provider in the home.
But why should it be of utmost importance to the single women?
No, but where are you going to get the support from? Mm. You are single and you have children. Where will you get the support from? You'll have to provide for them yourself, you know. And that's why I'm saying single parent, or maybe for some reason the man died or the marriage broke up or so on, and the children are with you. Even if the man is providing child support, it will not be enough to cover everything that the child or the children need. So the woman becomes the primary provider in the home. Because the primary provider is the breadwinner. The one who provides the basic needs of the home is the breadwinner.
But are female breadwinners a recipe for disaster?
Oh, I grew up in a female breadwinner home in the sense that my father died, so my mother had to raise us. And then in my own case, I had to raise my son, you know. So I don't know why it should be a recipe for disaster. I think perhaps it is when in a marriage situation, the woman is consistently the breadwinner. That, I think, will create problems. Because one, the man would begin to wonder, what am I doing in this house? If, again, he's not providing the other things. You know, some men are good. They would take care of the house help, you know, the boys in the house, make sure the garden is well kept. Even if they are not putting money in it, they run the home. They make you feel that, okay, I'm not in a position to earn an income. You are in a position to earn an income. But you won't come back home and have to do everything again yourself. There are some homes like that. So you find that the woman would say that, oh, I bring the money, but honestly, my husband is a good husband. He can't provide the money. But honestly, apart from that, I cannot have a better husband. There are some homes like that. That way is not a recipe for disaster. In homes where it has also been discussed, properly discussed. Maybe it is a temporary situation in the sense that, you know, these days of right sizing and so on, where redundancies occur, you could have a temporary redundancy which affects the man and keeps the woman still working. So that way, and you know, one of my fears right now is that we must not remove our attention from the boy child. We should pursue girl child education because we have to create a leveling up where more and more women are also educated. But what we want to do really is to create a society where boys and girls are well educated, where the whole society is well educated. Because if we lose it and we place the emphasis only, and I'm choosing my words well, only. Right now we're doing it because we haven't got to the stage where boys and girls together, you know, now it's more boys than girls. So we're trying to bring it together. But after a while, it should be boys and girls together so that you don't have a situation where we have raised a lot of well-educated professional women with their own businesses, their own vocations and so on. And the men are not able to catch up because they haven't been so well educated and so on. So I would say that we need a society where men and women consider themselves as complementing each other. I love what the Chinese say. The Chinese say that women hold half the sky. It means the sky will never be whole if there are no women. It will be lopsided. Can you imagine? And you're walking outside and part of the sky is falling on you because there are no women to prop it up to the same level. So I think we need to create a society where in the home, the responsibility is among the parents. Now, I won't even overemphasize who brings the money. So long as there's an understanding that the money needed is provided and that other things that should make the couple a strong couple, a loving couple, a couple that are responsible, I think it should be okay. But where you have a situation where the women are pushed to provide because the men are either irresponsible or are resentful because they are also earning, women are also earning money and they want the women to spend all their money, you will have problems that way. Or in a home where the man is just a boss, crosses his legs, and then everybody comes to pay obeisance, including the woman who has to go out and work and come and pay obeisance. I don't think that's going to help.
But if you are single,
yes,
not married,
mm-hmm.
yes, and not that you're a single mother.
Yes, you're single.
Yes, you're single, you're not married.
You win your own bread.
Yes, you win your own bread.
Yes, because
you're any more as at now.
Yes.
What should you do? Should you meet your Mr. Right? Is it important to discuss?
Money has to be discussed before marriage. Money and how the two of you are going to manage it. You should not feel shy about discussing certain things before you get married. You know, and sometimes you can tell when a man is also very mean with money. You go to a restaurant and then just when the bill is going to be paid, he goes to use the bathroom. Meanwhile, you are in a hurry, so you have to go. So by the time he comes, you've paid for it and would not even offer. That should tell you that, hey, this wonderful gentleman is not so wonderful with money. But I think it's something that you need to discuss. This is why I say that counselors, marriage counselors, always make sure they discuss the issue of money. And individual, the two of them as individuals, their relationship to money, their understanding of money, their feelings about money, And then they will call the two of them and see, how will you manage? They will probably ask a question, assuming that both of you are working and something happens and the man is no longer working. What are you going to do? How will you feel? They will ask the man, how will you feel when your wife has to provide everything? And then they will ask you too, how will you feel when you as the wife, you have to provide everything? You know, when people want to get married very badly, they'll find excuses as, oh, well, I'll try, I'll manage. And then when the reality hits, it's something else altogether. But these are issues that need to be discussed. Money has a way of generating a lot of peace and tranquility, or a lot of battles. And we have to constantly talk about it. Even whilst we're still married and we have a joint account, and or the man is taking care of everything and the woman doesn't have to spend anything, all the time we should be discussing some of these things and what will happen if.
But you know, the public is also divided as to whether women should even work at all. There are some who think, once, even if you're an educated woman and you have your own profession or something, once I get married to you, you need not work.
That's a pity, because, you know, the brain gets atrophied when it's not being used, gets stale. And therefore, once we get educated, it's good for ourselves as individuals. It is good for the home, and it is good for the nation. Now, I don't mind a woman not working at a certain time when the children are very young and need, you know, attention, quality attention. In fact, a lot of women feel guilty because they have little children. They have to work late at night, both of them, and really they don't have time. So if it is possible for the man to earn enough to take care of all of you, for you to stay at home for a while. But you see, there are these days of technology, there are many jobs too that can be done without taking you out
of
the home for length of time, which is not useful. So not working at all, I would say, it is not good. The man will not even like it done to his own daughter when the daughter grows up. Do you get me? And wouldn't like to see a sister, well-educated, sitting down at home. And when that happens, then all she does is to supervise people to run the home. What does she do? You know, the nation needs all the talents that we can have. The home also needs all the talents. So I wouldn't go for that. I wouldn't go for that. I think if you have a lot of money as the man, you should still get the wife working some way or the other. She can open an NGO, she can do something, she can work from home. Yes.
But is this issue of women being the breadwinners in homes sustainable in Ghana, especially where we have
it's been happening a lot. It's been happening a lot, and it's not only in Ghana. It's not only in Ghana, you know, it's been happening a lot. And now that we have needless wars and suicide bombings and so on, you're going to have more homes where it's the woman who has to take care of the home, because even your husband could be maimed and not able to work, you know, or will die and you're a widow, you know. Praise God we're living in Ghana, we don't have that kind of situation. You know, Ebola is going to kill some men and women are going to be widows, you know. So you can imagine, if you go to countries that have become war-torn, you'll be amazed at how many of those households are being taken care of by women, even if they are married. As I said, if through the war your husband gets maimed and is unable to work, are you going to leave him because he's maimed? No. It means you are going to have to work to take care of things. Yeah.
But should female breadwinners be a problem for families and even societies?
No, they shouldn't be. I think if anything, we must recognize that it does happen and is not going to go away. And so how does the society ensure that there's a social net that gives them comfort and helps them, supports them, you know, to be able to earn enough to take care of the home. It's not going to go away. It's not an issue that's going to go. No, it's not going to go away. So we have to recognize that it does exist, has existed for a long time, is going to be there for us for many years, but it should not be a negative situation. Should not be a negative situation. The ideal for every home is that there's a father, there's a mother, there are children. That ideal, it doesn't happen in some instances. Even where there's a mother and there's a father, you could have a situation where it is the woman who earns what it takes to run the home. But that home need not be dysfunctional if the two of them are building a home together. They will discuss it, they will come to an understanding, and the home will be a happy home. It does not have to be dysfunctional. Female breadwinners should not create a dysfunctional society. It doesn't, you know, because some women find themselves raising their children not because they are irresponsible, not because that is their choice, but it happens, you know, but they do it well. So we should rather find ways in which we support the singleness of women taking care of the home, and then the issue of women winning the bread that is used in the house. Yes.
That's fine. But let's take a little more of the comments on WhatsApp, then we'll come back quickly to wrap up.
All right.
But before then, let me ask this. What would be your advice for men who usually find that women are winning the bread all right, but their friends keep teasing them? Oh, it is even your wife who provides the
your
food.
Shirt.
Yes, and all of that. Because men usually complain a lot.
Yeah. Mm. Well, you see, every man should have a sense of self-worth and self-confidence. Now, you should be able to tell your friends that, you know, but you see how happily married we are. Mm. You are winning the bread. Your home is not very good. Or, you know, the two of us have discussed it and it works for us. It works for us. So we're enjoying it and our home is a very happy home. If it's because you're no longer working, you can say that, oh, don't worry. As soon as I get back my job, everything will turn around. Besides, we are fine like this. You know, we should learn to accept teasing without feeling guilty or feeling unworthy, you know. If it happens to be that way and you are willing to accept it and enjoy the home, why does it matter when your friends laugh at you? They will laugh at you if you are also providing everything and your wife is earning a lot of money and keeping the money to herself. They will laugh at you too, you see. So I think that our men who find themselves like that, please develop a sense of self-worth. You are still a man. Nothing has changed. Circumstances may not enable you to be the primary provider of the food, clothing, and shelter. But you're still a man. You're providing love. You're providing protection. You're providing companionship. You're providing intimacy. You know, you're giving your wife the respect. She's also giving you the respect. Frankly, what your friends say should not bother you.
Right. What your friends say should not bother you. That is coming from Auntie Joyce here. So please, men, just be calm. Nothing has really changed. What's up here? We have women are not to be the breadwinners, but men. That is why marriages today are not strong as it used to be in the days of Abraham and Sarah. We should go back to the Bible and learn more about marriages and what it stood for. Yes, women should not work. That is what God says. So we should obey it if you are a Christian. Anyway, you are entitled to your
views. No, but that is not also true. Because in the Bible, women have been known to work. You should go and read Proverbs 31, 10 to 31. Mm. What God says about the virtuous woman. She was working, she was an industrialist, she was a trader, everything. So please, the Bible says that you men, you should love us women the way Christ loves the church and gave his life for us. I can assure you, when you play your role, we would love you, earn money, set it aside for our common use, and we can all enjoy life together. If you do not want your wife to work and she's educated or even not educated, keeping her idle does not show that you respect her. And you said Sarah didn't work. At that time, Abraham was also not working for Volksbank or Deutsche Bank or GCB. They were farmers, and Sarah played a role. She played a role. It was usually the women who provided the cheese, they provided the curds and so on and so on. So she was working. She was working. She was working in the home. She was making sure that when the sheep come and so on, it will be nicely dressed and roasted and so on. So please, God wants us women to complete you. It means that we cannot do without each other. Let's see things from God's perspective and know that it is said in the Bible that Jesus' ministry was supported. Please read Luke 8 and from verse 2, that the Jesus' ministry was supported by women who brought their own income to support Jesus' ministry.
Magdalene, Dorcas.
Yes, Mary Magdalene, Joanna, the wife of Chuza, who was in the household of Herod. So please, don't let misinterpret the Bible.
Great. Well, this this man also says, I'm loving the show. Tell Auntie Joyce she's on point.
Thank you, sir.
This one from Kwesi from Kotobabi. I love the program. Keep it up. Where the woman become the breadwinner, should a man take care of the household activities when the woman is the breadwinner?
Not necessarily. Maybe both of you are working. But if, for example, you are at home and you can afford house help, supervising the house help doesn't matter. But I know men who love to cook. I know men who love to iron. And so if temporarily there's nobody to do it and the wife has gone to work, I know some men who are able to bathe their own children, read to them and put them to sleep. You know, women who are breadwinners would usually cook, put some in the freezer, will have a, what do they call this thing? Where you warm the food. I've forgotten the name.
Okay.
You know it. Microwave.
Aww.
Why did you forget it? Microwave. So, you know, so the man knows at a certain time, this food is there, I can take it, warm it, eat it, give some to the children, because the woman is not there. And the two of us understand each other. I know men don't feel good when it happens, but if it's temporary, then please accept it and do everything to become the breadwinner again. I can assure you, women don't like being the breadwinners all the time. I'm a woman, take it from me.
Wow. This person says, women being the breadwinners, this is the case since creation, but there is always a problem when the man is not showing any concern.
Yes.
May Allah help us all.
The home is supposed to be a loving home. You marry because you love each other. Even if you were given in marriage, it is expected that both of you understand the rudiments of marriage and you will each play your role. Because it's true, even now, in some cases, some cultures, you are married for somebody. But it is expected that you both understand the roles you play and play your roles well.
Yeah. Let's take this final one, then we conclude
shortly. Women should help men financially because men can't provide all due to the bad economy. So what is the duty of a woman whose husband do not work?
Yeah.
You did not add any name, but I would appreciate it if you add your name.
If the husband does not work, it should be temporary. Please, no man should not work permanently unless the person is injured and cannot work. The person is incapacitated and cannot work. And the woman understands it and is willing to work. But you, the man, should provide what the woman wants. Provide the love, provide the protection, provide the woman with dignity, and so on, make her feel good. Because she would also love to boast with you that though you do not work, you do everything else beyond what money can do. That is the way it should be. You know, when you are married, the two of you are supposed to be complementing, completing each other. It's an each other situation. And the Bible even says the two shall be one. When you are one, you know, Paul is so wonderful. He says somewhere that no man hates himself in Ephesians 5. He says, you know, men should love their wives because no man hates himself. So if you're loving your wife, you're loving yourself. So please do that. If for some reason you cannot work and the woman is working, talk about it, understand each other, still create that wonderful home filled with love, filled with joy, filled with harmony. And let everybody know, especially the children, that you really are a strong couple, a loving couple, and you are going to provide them the leadership they need.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Reverend Dr. Joyce Rosalind,
Auntie Joyce is enough.
Auntie Joyce is enough. Great. Yeah. We're passing through. We've been so much educated, and we have been talking about the issue of women being the new... Auntie Joyce have made the fact
that it's not new at all.
It's not new at all.
It's not new.
It's been there since. Mm. So she is the former CEO of the Chamber of Mines, a woman who has made great strides in the mining industry and currently the simple executive director of Salt and Light Ministries. And she has been helping us discuss the issue, women, the new breadwinners. I am Rebekah Awuah, and from the entire technical crew, we say thank you so much for being a part of the show. See you same time tomorrow.
Thank you.